All right, we have with us this morning on Hot Copy, Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel. Senator Pimentel, good morning to you and a happy new year.
Good morning, Karen, and to all of our viewers and listeners. Magandang umaga po, mayong buntag sa tanan.
All right, you've heard President Marcos speaking to business tycoons in Davos, Switzerland. What do you make of this trip to the World Economic Forum, given that there are problems that the country is facing, all the way from you have onions, rising prices of eggs, to other issues as well?
Well, we can now take advantage of technology. The president can still be informed about what ails the country or what is the immediate problem that needs his intervention. So I agree with his participation in Davos so that, you know, he can send the message that the Philippines is under a new administration, the new thrusts. He should explain his new thrusts, and that in the past administration, we also made some changes in our laws, in our legal regime. He should mention some of them. We also liberalize some aspects of our economy. So in that sense, since the people attending Davos are they believe in world trade, in a liberalized trade system, then in that sense, the ultimate message is that the Philippines is open for business. Put it under your radar, so that you are open to investing in the Philippines. So, but then, the topic of the Sovereign Wealth Fund or the Maharlika Investment Fund, I think, is premature. The president should not be announcing something to big business as if it is already a done deal, because we are only maybe around halfway of the process, because we have a two-step process, Karen. In passing a law, we must have a law to establish the Sovereign Wealth Fund or the Maharlika Investment Fund, and we are just halfway, two steps beyond. The first step is it should pass the House of Representatives, and then second step is it should also, the measure should also pass the Senate. Okay. Wala pa po sa Senate, not even a counterpart bill has been filed in the Senate.
Oh. So not even a counterpart bill has been filed, because one would think that given the supermajority in the Senate, the president is also, of course, presuming, hoping, and assuming that it would pass. Pero wala pang counterpart bill.
As far as I know, wala. Bakit? Because number one, was that Maharlika Investment Fund or the idea of a sovereign wealth fund mentioned in the SONA? Hindi. There has been a legislative executive meeting to identify the priorities. Was that identified as a priority? Wala. Because during those moments in time, there was no proposal about that. So that was never touched upon. So you see that, you know, this is like a spur of the moment idea which caught fire in the House of Representatives. So we cannot say that this has been a priority from the beginning of the Marcos administration.
Now, you've already seen so many administrations, gone through many presidents as well. What do you make of critics saying that an eighth trip for 7 months is office is too much? And yesterday, former NEDA chief Ernie Pernia says there will be no direct benefit to the country by going to the World Economic Forum. He sees that in a way as socializing with political elites, but in the past, it has not brought specific investments to the country.
Yeah, socializing with political and business elites, big business. But then sometimes, you know, you have to, this is part of public relations. You have to promote maybe some of them, although they're already elites, they have not heard of the Philippines. So this is, you know, one way of, you know, promoting the Philippines as a tourist destination, as an investment destination, or just merely bringing this to the attention of some people that there is a country such as the Philippines. It is in Asia, in Southeast Asia, and we have lost, and these are the examples of our loss. These are the principles in our constitution. Siguro, and I think we should. I think the our leader now can afford to travel because of the improved technology means of communication. So he can still, our president can still act as a president even if he's outside of the country by using the latest technology. So yun na po yun. But then there is still a problem. For example, in our hearing on the problem with the price of onion yesterday. Mm-hmm. What came out? So,
because he is concurrent agriculture secretary.
Yon, that is what I will point out. For example, kahapon, I think there is this, it's not about onion now, it's about the fertilizer support fund. Okay, that was brought out. Funds are already, have already been downloaded in the regional level. There is now a problem with the signing authority of the undersecretary. Because there is a cap or a ceiling to the amount that the undersecretary can authorize the disbursement of. But if that had been a secretary, in the undersecretary, but secretary, then that amount would be higher. But then the secretary is the president, so we have a problem now. So the persons who will sign would be undersecretaries. So therefore, they have reached the level, and then there is now a cessation of activity because they need to find out, should we now do something to increase the ceiling for the undersecretary, or do we wait for the secretary, who is the president, to sign now the document? So you see, this is these are unintended or unforeseen consequences of being concurrent secretary, the president being concurrent secretary of a department. So what is wrong with, or what is the disadvantage of appointing a regular secretary? There will be advantages. There will be an additional person to help you run or address agricultural issues. Diba? You can still concentrate on agriculture. Wala naman nagbawal dun eh.
But then in another setting, if there was a different agriculture secretary, the agriculture secretary would be attending the Senate hearings, and perhaps the senators would be lambasting the agriculture secretary. What's different in this situation is, how do you do that when it's the president himself who's the agriculture secretary and he has other responsibilities to deal with?
Yes, but we do not want them to appear in our hearing so that we can lambast them. We will lambast them, and there are good reasons to criticize them. But the point is, yun na nga, we are talking to undersecretaries, and then they can cite regulations providing the extent of their powers. Mm-hmm. So, at saka, if you just look at logic, though. The main problem is agricultural productivity. So we want to produce more using our land. There is nothing which prevents the president from making agriculture his priority, even if he has already a regular secretary. Therefore, logic tells us, if you appoint a regular secretary, there is an extra brain and a heart which will now help you address your priority. So, walang mawawala, may tulong pa.
Mm-mm. How important is it that the president already fill up positions that are still right now either have an OIC, or for example, agriculture, and then you have health, wherein Secretary Vergere is still OIC, and then apparently there are some posts under the armed forces as well that are not filled up. So, gaano kahalaga ito that tapusin na po niya?
Very important with the department secretaries, because as I mentioned yung kanina, undersecretaries have their limits, and OICs as well. The actions and decision-making processes of OICs, yung officers in charge, acting like a secretary, are not the same as the secretary, even the hiring of people below the secretary level cannot be done by the OIC.
Uh-oh.
So ganun po yun. So siya, if you want a more efficient governmental operations, then we should fill up the vacancies in government pursuant to the structure of government. So pagdating doon sa military, I believe they have a board. They have a board of generals. So let the process play out, no? So
But what does this say of his administration 7 months into it, that you have, for example, the latest, the National Security Advisor Clarita Carlos has been moved to another post and replaced by, I believe, General Anyo. So does this affect the stability of his administration? I mean, prior to that, you had changes in the AFP as well.
Well, ako kasi if one good trait is admitting that, you know, you made a mistake or a person is not in the proper position because his or her full potential is not being realized. So okay lang po ito, yung mga adjustments like this, part of governance po yan. Governance is actually an ongoing live experiment. Eh. So you put someone in a position, you find out now, although he or she is good, he or she is not a perfect fit for the position. So you look for the position where this person will realize the full potential in the service of the country. So okay lang po yon, okay lang po yung mga ganon. And then of course, yung mga secretaries, including the National Security Advisor, are alter egos of the president. It is as if siya din yon. So the president should get, you know, people that he fully trusts and that he is at ease with in working with them.
Okay. All right. Before we move on to other topics, I mean, let's be honest. It's been 7 months. It's the eighth trip. There's a trip after this. Is the president traveling too much?
It's difficult to give judgment on that, Karen, because, you know, the world has changed. There is, you know, ulitin ko, technology allows you to be on top of things even here in the Philippines. And you know,
but the traveling also takes expenses.
Yes.
I mean, right now they're asking for transparency, just right, with the expense and the delegation. The word is there are 13, but with the business delegation, allegedly, supposedly, it's ballooned to 70, which is bigger than other countries. So, is he traveling too much?
On the frequency, I think he's just honoring the invitations extended to him. So okay din po yun because that's part of our international relations. On the number of the delegation, I think this our big business people are paying for their trip, no, for their own expenses. But then we will come back to this issue during the next budget cycle because the OP has traveling expenses. It has also confidential and intelligence funds to the tune of billions of pesos. So tatanungin natin ngayon, no, kung naubos ba yung traveling expenses, what did they use to supplement the item for traveling, kung naubos man. But mabilis po maubos yun with the weak peso that we have. And then, of course, you spend in dollars when you're abroad.
Okay, moving on now to the bigger problem of the onion prices. What have you discovered? What's been revealed so far?
Masakit at masaba. I mean, onion farmers feel, those who have expressed themselves yesterday, feel that they are not fully supported. They are losing hope or... what is this? Ang term kasi, nawawalan sila ng gana na in onion farming because of the lack of government support. So what are the manifestations of the lack of government support? Cold storage facilities, wala daw. Okay. And even if there are, for example, in one province, Mindoro Occidental, there are two. Space is not, there are two physical cold storage facilities, but they are full. So there's no more space for the produce of local onion farmers. So what is taking up the space? Sabi nila, traders' onions. Not farmers' onions, traders' onions.
No, imported.
Yung traders' onions, most likely imported. So yun ang problema. And then farm gate prices, onions bought from them at 6 to 8 pesos, may 5 pesos pa daw. Mm-hmm. And then sold at 550 to 700 pesos per kilo around 5 months later.
Mm-hmm.
Maganda nga na realization ko kahapon eh. Sabi ng farmer from Mindoro Occidental, in February, March, April, we were farmers and our produce was bought from us from 5 to 8 pesos.
Mm-mm.
By September to December, we are already consumers. We don't have onions anymore. And we need to buy onions at 550 to 700 pesos per kilo.
Mm-mm.
Ang ganda nung ano eh. Only a farmer, an onion farmer, can give that insight. Karen, my dear friend.
But Senator, has it been explained why the prices are at 400 to 600 pesos per kilo? I mean, number one, is it a hoarding issue? Is it a cartel issue? Is it a lack of supply issue? Kumbaga, we do understand that there are problems in the chain. But why has it reached this price of 600 pesos per kilo? It's almost ridiculous to think. Anong dahilan daw po?
Right. Kaya nga, most likely, itong personal opinion ko, there's some price manipulation. And how do you manipulate the price? Yan, marami na yun. Sa supply chain, or use the supply chain as the reason for a decrease in supply, mga ganun. But kung makita natin, okay, there may really be a lack of supply from the domestic producers because the peak season, hindi na yan harvest season eh. Okay, number one. But was there a lack of world supply? Hindi po eh, because there is smuggling going on. Yeah. Therefore, had the DA been studying, you know, the seasons, harvest seasons, cropping season, alam na dapat nila yan. It's a 100-year-old, sabi ko nga kahapon, how old is the Department of Agriculture? It's more than 100 years old as a department. So, it should have institutional memory na the world has seasons, farming has seasons, ganun yun eh, cropping season, harvesting season. So alam na dapat nila that these are lean months, but the world supply is there, but they did not allow importation.
So who's
wrong timing?
Who makes that call? It's the agriculture secretary who makes the decision, right, when to import.
Yes, in this particular matter, because the agriculture secretary is the president of the republic with so many other issues, this has been delegated to a USEC and to a division head.
Which you believe
they were
not able to make the right decision, or they're not equipped, or they don't even have the power to make those decisions.
Yes, no, they can make the decision. The point is,
They can't sign.
For example, now they are making the decision to import now. February 15 is the harvest season. Mm-hmm. Okay. Ang tanong, during the lean months, yung non-harvest time, months before Christmas, which is the peak season for consumption, they did not make the same decision to import. Question is, why? Mga ganong tanong. Mga ganong tanong. And then do not tell me that sa DA, sabi natin, DA, do not tell to the person who made the decision, to that undersecretary or assistant secretary or the bureaucrat who made the decision, do not tell me that you do not know February 15 is start of harvest season for onions in the Philippines. Okay. And then do not tell me that August, September, hindi mo alam na walang harvest ng onion sa Pilipinas. Alam nila yon.
Alam ba talaga po ng mga nakausap ninyo, or bago po ang marami sa kanila?
Kahit, yun ang nga sinasabi ko. bago, pumasok ka sa 100-year-old institution with institutional memory. We know the seasons of the world, the seasons of life. Alam natin yun. Alam na dapat natin yun.
But then in a situation like this, who then takes accountability? It's very difficult then when it's the president himself that's agriculture secretary. How do you question the president who's busy, who's abroad, who is handling so many other things? If it were an agriculture secretary, it would be easier to get answers.
That's correct. But if we will still demand accountability, and then we will just go as high as we can. So those who really involve themselves in the decision making process. So this may be an agency head, a division head, an assistant secretary, up to an undersecretary, because that is now the structure of the Department of Agriculture. But we will have to demand some accountability, because may mga mali, and even the data keeping, Karen. I mean, I doubt their figures. They gave us figures. They reported the figures. When I asked about the figures, they gave us new figures determined the night before. So we do not know now. Ano ba itong figures? These figures given to us, like production figures, demand figures for onions. You know, you if you can change your figures just the night before the hearing, then if you notice some controversial figures, then you change them so that the hearing will no longer be controversial, there will be an issue to be raised. Kasi importante po sa agriculture, malaman natin, and our figures should be more or less dapat accurate on our production, domestic production of different agricultural products, and then domestic consumption of the different agricultural products. Why? Because the difference, pag sinasabing kulang si production sa demand, is the justification for importation.
All right. Okay, before we move on to another topic, so is it time for President Marcos Jr. to already choose an agriculture secretary?
It has long been time, Karen. I have been calling for that, or espousing the need for a regular agriculture secretary to be appointed. Nothing to lose. It's an additional expert person to help the president focus on agricultural issues and problems.